I would like to introduce your host for today's conference, George Smith. You may begin.
Thank you, Kathy. Good afternoon. I'd like to thank you all for participating in today's public meeting and webinar on 10 CFR Part 37, Physical Protection of Category 1 and Category 2 Quantities of Radioactive Material Program. My name is George Smith. I'm a senior project manager in the NRC's Office of Nuclear Materials Safety and Safeguards and the Division of Materials Safety State, Tribal, and Rulemaking Programs. I'm the team lead for the NRC's Part 37 assessment. We also have members of the Part 37 Performance Review Team in attendance here at the NRC headquarters and on the phone line that may ask additional or clarifying comments to ensure we accurately capture your public comments. This is a Category 3 public meeting. Your comments during this public meeting and webinar and those submitted to the NRC will be considered by NRC in preparing the report to Congress. However, the NRC does not intend to provide specific responses to comments or other information submitted in response to this request. We will entertain questions today during the public meeting and webinar and try to understand if they relate to comments you or other stakeholders may have regarding Part 37 and its guidance. The phone lines and all conversations are being recorded during the webinar. The operator will place you in a queue if you have comments to provide and inform you when you will be allowed to present your comments. Please do not provide non-public information, which is, for example, safeguards information or classified information, site-specific information about physical security systems, including design features of alarms, barriers, cameras, security, or communication systems. Information relating to on-site or off-site response force, including size, armament of response force, and arrival time of such forces committed to respond to security contingency events. Additionally, do not provide information such as guard force, law enforcement qualification and training, adversary characteristics, and related information, information from NRC issued orders that are marked SGI or SGIM. If you do not have the opportunity to submit your comments, or if you have additional comments, please go to the public meeting website to get the email and mailing address to submit this information. As most of you may know, the NRC published the final rule for the use and transport of Category 1 and Category 2 quantities of radioactive material on March 19, 2013. NRC licensees possessing the aggregated Category 1 and Category 2 quantities of radioactive material were required to comply with 10 CFR Part 37 by March 19, 2014. The House and Senate Appropriation Committee directed the NRC to evaluate the effectiveness of the new regulation and determine whether the requirements are adequate to protect high-risk radiological material and provide a report by December 2016. Today, we're going to be gathering general and specific comments on the overall effectiveness and the clarity of the requirements for security measures to protect Category 1 and Category 2 sources or radioactive material. And we'll be gathering comments on the usefulness of the guidance documents associated with Part 37. In addition to today's meeting, we have issued a Federal Register notice on March 14, 2016, requesting stakeholder comments. The FRN can be found on the NRC's Public Reading Room, 2016 Federal Register notice, page 13263, March 14, 2016. If you are not registered for the webinar and are only using the phone lines to participate in the webinar, please email your contact information to part37assessment@nrc.gov. We will identify the common areas in the 10 CFR Part 37 and the implementation guidance before soliciting public comments. At the end of the public meeting and webinar today, we will provide information on remaining webinars and public meeting dates. Actually, there's a change to that. This is the last webinar and public meeting that we're going to have in regards to soliciting comments for Part 37. The only areas of the 10 CFR Part 37 that the NRC is seeking comments are from subparts A, which are the general provisions, subpart B, background investigations and access authorization program, subpart C, physical protection requirements during use, subpart D, physical protection in transit. The only 10 CFR Part 37 guidance documents that the NRC is seeking comments are from New Reg 2155, Implementation Guidance for 10 CFR Part 37, and New Reg 2166, which is the Physical Security Best Practice for the Protection of Risk Significant Radioactive Material. As a reminder, we will not be providing responses to stakeholder feedback. However, we will entertain some questions today if you have some clarifying questions that we can answer. But the focus is on receiving some of your comments and feedback on the rule and its guidance. Please do not provide non-public specific information pertaining to security measures. And as a reminder, the phone lines and all conversations during the webinar are being recorded. Prior to providing comments, we ask that you provide your name and organization that you're representing. We ask that you provide very short, succinct comments during this webinar so that we can afford as many stakeholders as possible an opportunity to provide comments. We'll provide a time check throughout the public meeting and webinar today, just to keep everyone aware of the time that we have left for today. So we're going to start with subpart A, and throughout the public meeting and webinar today, we'll give you an opportunity to provide your comments. If we're on another subpart or we're talking about the guidance document, and if you want to provide comments on an earlier question or comment or subpart that we were talking about, you may do that. The timeline is pretty loose. So we'll give you an opportunity that if something jogs your memory that you want to go back to one of the previous conversations or comments or question, you can do that. So Kathy, we're going to start on subpart A. Is there anyone on the line that may have some questions on subpart A?
Okay, please press the star one and please record your name and your organization.
Specifically, we're looking to understand if there's any comments on the clarity of definitions. Some of the comments we've gotten in the past have been about barriers. Stakeholders believe that the definition of the barriers or what constitutes an adequate barrier. That we need some clarification on that. So if you have those comments, we'd like to hear from you.
There are no questions or comments at this time.
Okay, thank you. Also, if you believe that there are some areas in Part 37 that need that we should add definitions to, we'd like to hear about that. We've described security zones, but some still have questions or believe there should be a definition, for example, for a security zone. So, if you have that that concern, we'd like to hear about it.
Let's press star one.
Again, if we move forward, and if you would like to provide that information later into today's public meeting and webinar, you could definitely do that. But we're going to move on to subpart B. We've gotten a lot of comments on subpart B, particularly where those who are not as comfortable with making TNR determinations or believe that the NRC should provide a description of what constitutes trustworthiness and reliability. So we've gotten some of that feedback. We'd like to get more comments if you have any comments on subpart B.
And press star one. one question. One moment. Karen, go ahead with your question and state your name and organization.
Hi, this is Karen Sheehan. I'm from the Fox Chase Cancer Center. And we're having a very difficult time with getting unescorted access for some of our people who are foreign nationals. It's taken almost close to a year from their initial application to get the information that we need from the past 7 years. And another issue that we've come across is a woman who was a stay-at-home mom for a period of time, and we're not sure how we get any verification for this period, which was in the 7 years that she was at home with her children. I would like maybe some guidance on how we could do this. Thank you.
So, Karen, before you leave, and we've gotten a lot of feedback on foreign nationals with stakeholders not a couple of things. Not being able to get the information for a seven-year period. Also, just trying to verify some of the information when someone's from a foreign country. So, is there a clarity issue there that we should? Do you have a recommendation there, or do you just think that we're not clear as to what we require from foreign nationals, or do you believe that perhaps? We should identify another process, or simplify the process in some other manner. Any thoughts there?
Well, our most difficult thing is confirming their education, and I would suggest that maybe if the principal investigator who hired them could possibly vouch for their education, at least in the United States, that may be helpful. That's the difficulty, because we ask for diplomas to prove their education, and that is extremely difficult to get. And I'm not sure what the solution, would be for that. And as far as the stay-at-home mom, we were going to try to get some verification from her neighbors that she was actually there, or maybe a daycare center that she took her kids to. This is the first time we've run into that. So I really don't know how we can, in some situations, get the information. So what our solution would be not to give them unescorted access, because we can't follow the regulation of getting 7 years worth of information.
Do you have any? Thanks for the comment. This is Paul Goldberg from NRC. I just had a question on your education concern. For education within the United States, are you saying you can't get a diploma or a transcript?
No, within the United States, we're not having a problem.
Okay.
It's the people who were educated in another country.
And
because at Fox Chase, probably all facilities, they do have a lot of people from other countries, who work at their facilities. And to get this information, for example, from Russia, is extremely difficult. Sometimes they don't even have their diplomas, even though they did, graduate. So I just wanted to make a comment that this is, very hard to do.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, if we can't get it, then we're just going to have to not give them the unescorted access. We try our best. And we have to have a cutoff point, because there's other people waiting to take our class, our training class, which is a requirement for safe use. And we can't hold up the class of others waiting almost a year to get some of the information for the foreign nationals. So we just have to move on. but I just wanted to make the comment, and I'm sure everyone has the same issue, that it is extremely difficult.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you for the comment. Karen, are you still there?
Yes.
Now, the other one with the stay-home mom, we've had comments as to, you know, for example, some stakeholders have looked at the previous employer, but then, you know, the comment was, you know, is it clear that we're supposed to verify, for example, in this case where you have someone that's a stay-home mom, you know, are we required to, you know, make any type of verification there? So that there appears to be some need for clearer guidance in that case, but we've not heard about a, you know, someone who was a, you know, who stayed home, and, you know, and so how do you document that? So we really appreciate that comment.
Well, there also could be the case of someone who is just not employed for a period of time as well.
Correct.
And that could be the same situation. They just didn't have a job. You know, they were out of work for some reason. Maybe it was between graduation and, you know, getting a job. So that's another area that I'm concerned about. We're not going to be able to verify.
Okay. Thank you, Karen. Really appreciate
your
comments.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Kathy, do we have anyone else?
There's no other at this time.
We've also gotten feedback from others on, you know, once they provide the unescorted access for those who are, especially in the education at the universities or research institutions, you know, you have the students that come and they come and they go. So, you know, there's a need for that process to be able to terminate the employees. So, some stakeholders have had concerns with that, with they having so many students coming through and they're providing unescorted access, a mechanism to terminate that unescorted access. You have any questions? Also, we've gotten feedback that you know, some stakeholders would think that the you know, they would like the NRC to be more involved in the TNR process and maybe making some of those TNR decisions. We have in information in Annex A that help our reviewing officials to understand to help reviewing officials to make TNR determinations. You have any we've gotten feedback on Annex A to Part 37. I'm sorry, New Reg 2155. I don't know if anyone now, if you have any kind of feedback on that information that we've provided. Is it clear? Would you like for us to expand on the information to help in TNR determinations?
Again, please press the star one.
Also, we recognize that we do have quite a bit of states to have to register for the webinar. So we'd like to hear from you also if you're from one of the states. You know, your experiences because you're recently implementing Part 37. So. And you would have equivalent type of requirements. So we'd also like to hear from the states if you have some feedback that you know that we can consider with Part 37. Oh, you have some. We do have someone in the public meeting, attending the public meeting, that will provide some feedback.
This microphone?
Sure.
Okay. My question has to do with subpart B, fingerprinting.
Can you let everybody know who you are?
Oh, sorry. Kathy Roboto, National Institutes of Health. So we have quite a large radiator security program for our license. 3729B has a heavily utilized text that we make use of. However, it has a tie-down condition for fingerprinting. This is for identification and criminal history records check. It mandates that as long as the fingerprinting has been within the last 5 years, it does not need to be redone for a new applicant. That's occasionally caused us hardship because we have longtime employees whose fingerprinting criminal history records check is greater than 5 years old. So for only purposes of this one regulation, do we have to route them through the whole criminal history records check again? They don't need to repeat their background investigation, just the fingerprinting portion of it. If you look at comparing that text of the regulation with 3727, which is probably where most licensees would turn for fingerprinting guidance, there's a similar, in 3727.4, there's a similar allowance that if someone came from another licensee and already had fingerprints, criminal history records check performed, you can accept it as another licensee. But here, there is no tie-down condition that has to be within the last 5 years. So it just seems to be a little bit of a discrepancy to me. And if I were able to offer a recommendation that would be to my benefit, I would say, let's drop that 5 year. It would allow me to save people the effort of repeating the criminal history records check.
So Kathy, for clarification, so you're saying in 3729B, if you performed a criminal history check for some other purpose, but
right.
Now the person is coming for Part 37, you
right.
can't use that criminal history check?
If it's outside the 5 year window.
Right, if it's outside. But if that individual is coming from another organization, you can use their fingerprint.
Because their outside organization had done the fingerprinting check for purposes of Part 37.
And that's even if it's outside of the 5 year time period?
It doesn't address timeliness of the.
Oh, okay.
So I would have presumed a 6 year old criminal history records check, if it came from another licensee, would have been deemed acceptable. That's how I read 3727.4. 3727A.4, just to get the regulation properly quoted.
Okay. Great.
I hope that makes sense.
Yeah.
Sufficient.
Any comment from any room? Paul? Duane? No? No? Okay. Great. Thank you. And I would say, you know, we've gotten a lot of good feedback, like with the yeah, with Kathy has just provided and Karen has provided. So, you know, again, if you have any feedback for subpart A or subpart B, we would like to hear from you at this time.
Please press the star one for any comments or questions.
Also, you know, we've gotten feedback for reviewing officials, you know, having a health science background and not being comfortable making TNR determinations. I don't know if that's been your experience, but if that's the case, we'd like to hear about that also. Also, you know, we've heard some stakeholders will, you know, especially like at some of the federal facilities or universities where they may have a law enforcement component. You know, they may have like the law enforcement component performing, you know, some pieces of the TNR process, the fingerprinting and reviewing some of the background information that they receive to help in that TNR determination. So we've gotten some of that feedback, and we've actually got one person who was concerned that you know, that process is bifurcated in that manner, and that you know, if you have that concern, or if you have experience with that, we'd like to hear from you. And we do have some folks in the room, so if, you know, I'm reading my notes, so if you have a question, just, you know, do it, Kathy, to just get my attention. Yell at me. It's about 1:25, so we do have a lot of time left. So I'm trying not to rush the process. But again, if you're not clear on the barriers, or if you have any comments on subpart B, we'd like to hear about it. You know, we've had some comments on the a continuous barrier. You know, the definitions of a adequate barrier. So that was really good feedback. And again, we've had a lot of feedback on comments on subpart B. So if you have any of those comments, please let us know. Okay, if we don't have any comments on subpart B or subpart A, we're going to move on to subpart C. Again, if you know, within the conversation, if you believe you do have comments and you'd like to make comments, you can make comments on subpart A or B at any time during this process. Subpart C, we've got a lot of comment on the support for physical protection of the sources. A lot of feedback on local law enforcement coordination. A lot of the stakeholders believe that that requirement, that they've not had the opportunity to coordinate with local law enforcement because LLEA, the local law enforcement agency, will not commit to a certain time period because they prioritize their responses. So if you have some of that feedback, we'd like to hear about it. But again, as you provide feedback, again, we'd like to remind you not to provide any non-public information, especially, it's easy in this piece this subpart with subpart C when we're talking about the physical security of the sources. So no public information or safeguarded information or classified information if you do provide any type of comment. Also from the universities, some of the feedback was around the relationship that you have with your local law enforcement at a university, and the point was that a licensee may contact the local law enforcement for the mere fact that it's an incident that's occurring, and so where does that line? Where's the distinction as to when the licensee has to notify the NRC if they're notifying local law enforcement? So if you have that experience, or if you think there needs to be some clarity there, we'd like to hear those comments. Also, with subpart C, and we'll get into that, I guess, more with the new Reg 2166, but some stakeholders have talked about the fact that it's been helpful to have some of the retired police officers, or if they have a security force or a local law enforcement force at their facility, they've relied upon that entity to help them establish physical security measures. And some have really relied on that, those who have been, retired they could be they actually have law enforcement at their facility, and some of those law enforcement personnel at their facilities are actually retired local law enforcement, and they found that to be very helpful. Again, we like to hear about the continuous barriers also, which constitutes the security zone. If you have any comment on that, we'd like to hear about it.
Again, please press the star one.
It's about 1:30, so we have quite a bit of time left if you'd like to make comments. And also, we'd like to remind you that if you do not make comments today, or if you believe that you'd like to make additional comments, you can always make those comments by May 13th to be considered for our assessment efforts. Just go to the either www.regulations.gov, or you can go to the public webpage and submit your information. You can also mail that information into the NRC, and that's on the public webpage also. We ask that you always include the docket number if you're going to send that information in via email or if you mail it in. The docket number is the docket ID number is NRC 2015-0109. You know, one of the other things we're doing during this assessment is we're looking at the outreach process that we've engaged in to inform the stakeholders on the assessment, I mean, not assessment, but Part 37, the requirements, the guidance. You know, we've gotten feedback from some who are not getting that information timely. So if you have that that issue, we'd like to have that feedback also. We've gotten quite a bit of information on security zones, as far as establishing security zones and controlling access to security zones. So if you have any feedback on security zones, we'd like to get that feedback. Speaking of subpart B, some of the feedback we've gotten is some believe that the 10-year period to reassess those for trustworthiness and reliability, doing the background checks, whatever, it's just the 10-year period is a long periodicity, that it should be maybe 5 years or 3 years or 2 years. If you have any feedback on that, we'd like to hear about it. I mean, one stakeholder made sure we understood that, you know, 1 to 2 years is that period is too short. That would be a burden on licensees to try to, because some licensees have quite a bit of employees or students that they provide unescorted access to. But some believe that the 10-year period was a long period to have a person to be reassessed. Also, we've gotten some feedback on having some sort of or that some stakeholders actually implement a process where they are looking at their employees on a more frequent basis. They've instituted that process themselves. Instituted that process. So if you have that experience, we'd like to hear about that also and how you're implementing your process. If there are any PRT members on the line that would like to pose any additional questions, you can at this time.
Hello. I had a request to see if anybody out there has any concerns about the way the word aggregated is defined in Part 37.
Great. And that's Bob Catone from Region 3 NRC. Thank you, Bob. So that's one of the areas we're looking at. It the definition of aggregation, is that clear? Do you understand what the definition of aggregation? Is that a better term? term to use as opposed to collocation. Is collocation clearer than a term aggregation? Bob, do you have any other questions you'd like to pose?
Yeah, I wondered if there were opportunities to more clearly understand what's meant in the rule in terms of monitoring, detection, and assessment.
Great, thank you.
In a specific context of what I've asked for, there have been some comments or discussions in previous webinars where a licensee employee drives a vehicle with Cat 2 material and parks the vehicle with that material inside the vehicle in a hotel parking lot while the employees are in the hotel overnight. So again, this would be focused on detection, assessment, and response to an intrusion to the vehicle containing that material. If there's any clarity that you think might be worthwhile, you know, for us to consider, please say so.
Great, thank you. So it's about 20 minutes till 2, so we do have quite a bit of time if you'd like to make comments.
Again, for comments, please press the star 1.
And as I mentioned earlier, if you'd like to make comments and you don't make those comments today, you have to May 13th. You can email that information to us. You can mail it to us. You can get that information on the public website. You can ask to where to mail the comments.
One of the other feedback that we had was involving weekly checks of Category 2 material in terms of how to do that to comply. So if there's any clarity, suggestions on that, please provide it.
Okay, not hearing any feedback, any statements or comments for subpart C. We're going to move on to subpart D. And again, I'd like to remind you that you know, the all comments or conversations on the phone lines are being recorded today. Also, if you provide any feedback, please do not provide any non-public information, safeguarded information, classified information. And if you have comments on subpart A, B, or C, you can provide it at any time. So if you have any comments on subpart D, we'd like to hear from you at this time.
Okay, please press the star 1.
Again, there was a question there with reporting of events in subpart D. So if you have any questions there, we would like to hear from you. The clarity of the requirements to report events. One of the comments we have received was, again, you have your facility or you have a vehicle with Category 1, Category 2 source, for example, in it, and someone has broken into the vehicle. Do you have to report that information if it's clear to you that the person was trying to steal, for example, a phone on the front seat of the vehicle and not get access to the material, the Category 2 material in the back of the vehicle? We had gotten feedback and comments on that you know, that may not be as clear. Again, if you have any comments on subparts A, B, C, or D, we'd like to hear from you at this time.
We have one coming up. One moment.
Okay, Mel, go ahead and state your name and organization.
My name is Mel Frable with Concrete Imaging Incorporated. I work at temporary job sites in industrial radiography, performing concrete radiography throughout the D.C. Baltimore metropolitan area. Question is, I keep hearing about this leaving Category 2 material in a parking lot in a locked-up vehicle overnight. My thing is, when I have a isotope in a vehicle, I was plainly told that I have to have eyes on that device the entire time that that device is out of permanent storage. Why is this being, I think that rule needs to be stricken. That should be banned. They shouldn't be allowed to have an isotope, and even if it does have anti-theft, GPS and everything else on it, that still doesn't suit well as far as I'm concerned. Thank you.
So your comment is that a licensee shouldn't be allowed to store a source in a vehicle overnight in a hotel?
Correct. I mean, because I was plainly told, by an NRC inspector doing an audit, that I had to have eyes on a device at all times. Even if it's locked in the storage in the truck, there has to be eyes, there has to be someone in the truck or eyes on the truck at all times. That device is out of public storage, permanent storage. So to me, that's, keeping a device in a motel with remote sensing devices and stuff, that still doesn't sit well as having a human being out there watching that piece of equipment.
Great. Thank you, Mel.
There are no other questions or comments.
We do have a comment here in the public meeting.
Hello, Kathy Roboto, National Institutes of Health, again. So I'm going back in time a little bit to subpart B.
Okay.
This is 37.25, background investigations. I don't know the basis for the requirement that states the background investigation must encompass at least the 7 years preceding. I don't know if that was just an arbitrary number chosen or if there's some basis for choosing 7 years. In my particular case, we have quite a large program of folks. We have to TNR, undergo a trustworthy and reliable determination. And at our facility, all badge holders automatically get a background investigation that goes back 5 years. So this 7 years is a hardship because on top of the investigation they're already required to get on the basis of their employment, now for categories of people who are not federal employees anyway, I have to request this additional 2-year gap. And that's a problem. An earlier caller had said for nationals in particular. That's certainly the case for us, and I would echo the difficulties that for nationals pose to become eligible for TNR. It's a really tough case. But even for U.S. citizens, this 2-year gap poses a lot of administrative difficulties. Because we're such a large program, it's a workload issue, and it's also a matter of it seems duplicative. In our case, that if it were possible to make that a 5-year look back, then the default background investigation that OPM defines for all federal facilities as minimum would suffice, and there wouldn't be a need for an extra above and beyond 2-year or however many years on top of that.
Okay.
If that's possible, consider.
Great, thank you. Any feedback on the 7-year period, the background on that?
This is Willie Lee. Kathy, are you suggesting perhaps 5 years would be more appropriate, and you have a reason for saying that?
5 years, in my opinion, would be appropriate because it would make my program a whole lot of easier to implement. So from my own program's perspective, 5 years is the default look back that everybody gets. And it wouldn't be an additional burden just for the TNR population of folks.
I also don't really know what the additional 2 years gets you from a security perspective, because 5-year look back versus 7-year look back, the elements won't change for most of the things you're looking at. The education won't have changed. The personal references won't have changed. It's really just the additional employment they may have had for those 2-year gaps. The look back would go a little bit farther in time for an employment verification. But we already do the education verification and the personal reference with the 5-year look back. So the only thing you're gaining is an additional 2 years beyond the most recent 5 years for employment verification feedback. Is that really relevant from a security perspective? Will it give you added information that justifies the burden of going 7 years back versus 5 years?
Is that
along the lines of an explanation you're looking for?
Well, yes, and I was trying to remember back to the Part 37, the statements of consideration. I think it was discussed briefly, but I don't recall exactly where the 7 years came from. But it seems like it may have been involved with some things that were in the public record, maybe like credit checks, that kind of thing. But
But then credit checks went away.
But it's not part of Part 37, so.
Correct.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank
Great.
You.
Thank you very much. Again, we're soliciting feedback from our comments from subpart D, but if you have any comments on subpart A, B, C, or D, we would like to get them at this time. And again, you know, a lot of the comments we've gotten, I mean, they're, it's, you know, on the line of what we're hearing today. And if there's clarity that we need to pursue or really look at some of the processes, such as the 7-year as opposed to 5 years, you know, we'd like to hear those type of comments.
I do have a comment from Aaron Sheehan.
Karen,
sorry.
Go ahead, Karen.
Hi, this is Karen Sheehan again from Fox Chase Cancer Center. And I'm not sure if it was you, but someone mentioned about the maybe feedback on the direct visual surveillance in subpart C, and the category 2 surveillance in particular, weekly verification. It states in C2 that it needs to be through physical checks, tampering, indicating devices, use or other means. So can it be a combination of those, or does someone have to every week physically walk down to check to make sure that the source is there by using a meter? I just wanted to see if a clarification on that.
Karen, this is Paul Goldberg. You're talking about 3749?
Yes.
A3II?
It's actually C II. Well, it's kind of hard to tell because there is an A at the top.
3749C, you're talking about? I think you're talking about 3749A3II, the weekly verification for Category 2
yes,
material?
Yes, yes.
Okay. It could be a combination of means. We would just want to see that the licensee had a procedure for doing this in some fashion on a regular basis. And if, for example, you ordinarily do it through use, there are materials that are taken out daily or several times a week, but there are occasions when they're not taken out for a week or two at a time. We could accept certainly that you ordinarily do it through use, but other times you you do weekly verification through physical checks.
Well, also, we would like to include the fact that we didn't receive any alerts that any tampering indicated devices were compromised.
Well, this is a separate requirement. You mean you didn't receive any checks that people entered the area?
Well, they don't always. We, as far as use, we don't always have a user every week.
Right.
Or every 2 weeks. But in the regulation, it states that it could be through tampering indicated devices.
Right. Yeah, well, these would be devices that indicate tampering.
Which we have with
the material, not just entry into the security zone.
No, we have other security methods that include a indication if the source was tampered with itself.
Yes, that would be adequate if those are checked at least weekly.
Well, that's monitored 24/7.
Okay, so these are alarms or sensors,
yes,
of some sort?
Sensors, yes, that were put in through GTRI.
Okay, and they are continuously monitored?
Yes.
Well, I think that would be acceptable.
Okay, so it's really for us, it would be a combination of use and the physical presence and the tampering devices. I just wanted to make sure it didn't have to be a physical check only.
Right. No, it has all those measures, and you can combine them as necessary as long as we know that you have a program to do that.
Yes.
Now, Karen?
Yes.
Just as a quick comment, so Paul is commenting on what you've described to him. Obviously, Paul is not going to be the one to go out and do inspections on you. So, make sure with your regulator that describe it to your regulator so you can speak more. You can get into non-public information so you can get a good description. But I think Paul is commenting on the fact that, yes, you can use a combination of those methods. It doesn't have to be a single method in order to meet the requirement 3749A3. Just want to make sure I clarify that.
Yes, we certainly would review this with our regulator, and it is part of our security plan. It's mentioned that we will use a combination of all of them. I just didn't want to make sure that I wanted to make sure that that was okay.
Great.
That it would be a combination.
Great, thank you.
Okay.
Based on that discussion, does anybody out there think there's a need to provide more clarity with that requirement?
Well, even Karen, do you think that needs to be more clear?
I think it could be more clear. It could maybe say through one of the following or a combination,
right.
I think that would make it a little clearer.
Great. Thank you, Karen.
Thank you.
Thanks for the follow-up, Bob.
Okay.
George, I have two comments from the webinar.
Great.
Both are from Mac Richard. One on the previous topic that Karen just brought up. His comment is that constant video surveillance would also appear to meet the weekly requirement to ensure the radioactive material would be present. And then Mac had a follow-up comment to what Kathy brought up, which is that our human resources group also typically use a 5-year interval for new employees. The seven years does cause an additional burden for no apparent benefit.
Great, thank you. Also, I'd like to emphasize the fact that you can submit your questions through the webinar. That's one thing I didn't mention earlier. So, Paul, you had some follow-up.
Yeah, with respect to the first comment there about continuous video surveillance, this would have to be somebody continuously watching the source. If that's what you're talking about, we just require weekly verification. So I'm not sure what the continuous video surveillance would involve.
So who was it? Was it Mark? Mac? So Mac, if you have if you've called in, if you could maybe provide more insight, or you can provide that insight through the webinar. Just clarification, so would really help Paul to understand exactly what your comment is exactly, and that would help us understand if some clarification is needed there, or perhaps Paul could actually answer your question. Again, if you have any feedback in subparts.
Mac?
Yes.
Your line is open.
Okay. This is Mac Richard, and I had trouble getting the phone to work a minute ago, so that's why I was typing. The question about what I mean by constant video surveillance, we have video. I mean, our campus police department is tied into video on the entrance to the rooms where these sources are located, and as such, I can't say they're sitting there looking at that camera 24/7, but it's one of several constant video systems that are operational. So that's kind of what I mean. And then, of course, the tamper indicating devices, and I think one of the other folks mentioned the GTRI systems. Those tamper indicating devices are always present, and they indicate if there's anything wrong with them or they fail, we get an indicator that there's something wrong with that device. So, again, that's a constant, I mean, that's constantly operational 24/7. So it would seem to me that if you've got constant things like that going on, the weekly verification, I mean, it's not like we go down and check off that we do this weekly. It's constantly going on.
Right, Mac, just a couple of things. But in this conversation, just want to remind you too, not to provide any non-public information.
Right, I know.
Now, so what organization are you with again?
Indiana University.
Oh, Indiana, okay. Well, just a quick comment. As far as the GTRI, those, you call it upgrades or... enhancements. Okay, we'll call it enhancements. So the GTRI enhancements, do you understand as far as the GTRI enhancements meeting part and that in conjunction with meeting Part 37 requirements, have there ever been a question as to, utilizing those enhancements for meeting Part 37 requirements?
Well, absolutely. I mean, we had an NRC inspection about the 1st of March, and obviously with those enhancements in place, the inspectors feel like that our program in combination with that met all the requirements.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Sure.
We do have a comment from Chris. Chris, please state your name and your organization.
Hi, this is Chris Dugan with TUV Rhineland. I had a question regarding Subpart C, or just a comment for clarification regarding the general security program requirements and the protection of information. Part D gives a number of documents that are required only for those with unescorted access. And my question was for clarification whether or not our actual physical license would fall within that criteria, and if so, how would that apply to the postings of that license under Part 19?
So your question is, would your license part, I'm sorry, fall under the need to be protected?
Correct, yeah. It's not stated in Part 37, but it's one of those items that have come up during numerous audits and discussions, whether or not the actual physical license should only be available to those with unescorted access, given the information that's on it. And then how would that affect how I should post it per the requirements of Part 19?
And Chris, what's your last name and what organization again?
The last name is Dugan, D-U-G-A-N, and I am with TUV Rhineland.
Okay, great. Thanks. Paul, do you have any feedback?
Yeah, Chris, thanks. Thanks for the question. So I think you're talking about 3743D, provision on protection of information. So ordinarily, we just require protection of the security plan, the implementing procedures, and the list of people with unescorted access. Your license itself would not ordinarily have sensitive information in it, security-related information. You somehow do have sensitive information in that, you ought to probably discuss it with your regulator, because ordinarily there wouldn't be.
And you wouldn't. I don't think there's necessarily a defined sense of it. It was just the thought that with that information, you could have an address, the type of location, model, make, you know, things along that line where that might be considered part of it. You know, just a thought.
Well, we try to avoid making public any information which identifies licensees where category one or two, which have category one or two material or licenses, addresses where it's located. So, as a general matter, we would avoid making that public. But we don't require particular measures under Part 37 to protect it.
Okay. Because Part 19 will require for me to post that license.
This is Bob Gattone. Some of the licenses that they would be marked if they're NRC that would say on the top and the bottom, office use or official use only, security-related information, and that goes with what Paul just said. So if you find that your license is marked like that, then you should keep it, secured. And then if an inspector comes and asks, wait, why didn't you post the license? Or you could also post a note where it is or how to get to it for people that are interested in reading it. And then because that's security-related information. And then once the inspector understands that, then there shouldn't be an issue.
Yes, Bob, that's currently the status we do. We have just a posting saying that the license can be stored, is found for review at the RSO's office. But, sometimes it goes one step further with any type of hard copies that the guys have. They must keep controlled anything that's emailed back and forth. So I know the license doesn't fall underneath the Part 37, but just was curious.
Okay.
Great, thanks.
Yeah. Chris, we do have some additional guidance that on that in under a regulatory issue summary document. It's designated RIS 2005-31, which says how you should handle any information that is sensitive, that's sensitive, unclassified, non-safeguards information.
Thank you.
Thank you for the comment. Thanks, Paul.
We do have Mac with another comment.
One of the things that and from the practical side, we're a broad medical licensee, and vendors that we ship materials to will request copies of our license. And, of course, that license has, a list of, these various sources, model numbers, et cetera. So the practical approach we've taken with that is to simply we will scan that license into a PDF file, redact that information, which just you basically block it out so they can't see the source information, et cetera, et cetera. And the cover letter goes with that license and basically says this license includes redacted information that is not germane to, you know, your particular use. If you have a problem with that, contact us. And that's kind of how we dealt with that, and that seems to work pretty well.
Great, thanks. Thanks for the comment, Matt.
Yeah, Mac, are you familiar with the license verification system?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Do you go through that for that purpose? If you're shipping material, you're shipping material to the vendor, is that what you're talking about?
No.
We're receiving material from the vendor. All right. Well,
yeah.
they should be able to check LVS for your license. Most of the vendors are familiar with that.
The other thing that can happen with universities, if we do have to ship material from one licensee to the other, they may ask for a copy of our license as well. So, okay. I mean, as I said, we've done the redaction approach, and that seems to work. And maybe some of the vendors aren't aware that they can do that either.
Yeah, I mean, that's an acceptable approach. Generally, if you ship on any sort of regular basis, it's maybe easier to use the license verification system.
Right. Yeah, we don't, fortunately. Normally, we're on the receiving end, not on the shipping end.
Well, I would just expect vendors to generally use it, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
All right, thank you.
Hey, we have a comment from Andy Welding.
Yes, this is Andy Welding at the University of Notre Dame, and it's more of a question maybe than a comment. We have the campus police force with sworn officers who, of course, are permitted to have unescorted access to the sources. But the question or the concern that I'm dealing with is the access to the security plan and the implementing procedures. We have people on the security staff who are not sworn officers and would never really need to have a need to have unescorted access to the sources, but wanting to train them to know, for example, if there's an incident where these sources are located and to alert the dispatch people to get sworn officers to the site, how extensive do we need to do called a TNR program without the fingerprinting process, of course, but who should really be involved in the background checks and that sort of thing for non-sworn officers?
This is Paul Goldberg. So for people who aren't TNR but need to know something about the security plan, you can train them on the portions of the security plan that they need to know about. If they have access to the material, they definitely have to be TNR'd.
No, they would not. They would not.
If they have access to the sensitive information, they would also have, that is, the security plan, the implementing procedures, and the list of unescorted, of people with unescorted access, they also have to be TNR'd, but without fingerprinting.
Right.
If it's something short of that, that they just need to know, if you see this alarm, call this number, for example, call local law enforcement or respond to this area that doesn't involve access to the sources, you can just train them on that without having to worry about additional the TNR requirements under Part 37.
Yeah. Well, that's where I just kind of question where the term implementing procedures stop and end. Obviously, these are not people who are going to be making an armed response, but they will need to maybe notify an officer to make an informed response.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think I've got it clear. But for example, we're going through this process. We've gone through this process with our dispatch personnel, but not necessarily. Do we necessarily need to do it? For example, for the person that does nothing but write traffic tickets, we're training him to be alert to parking tickets. I mean, we're training him to be alert to any sort of suspicious activity near the facility. But would that require TNR for that type of information?
No, I wouldn't think so.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
And again, Andy, for clarity, are you still there?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, so just like that person you're training, just to the person that's writing tickets, you just training them to alert, you know, the other police authority if they see something suspicious, and that's it. You're not, you know, explaining your facilities and what's stored in the facilities and the process of access to facility. You're not giving them any other non-public information. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, great.
Yeah, Andy, let me refer you to part 3743C of the rule, okay, which is training. And in our guidance document, New Reg 2155, we have some additional questions and answers that bear on what you're talking about. On page 134, example, question and answer 4, the rule requires the extent of the licensee security training for affected individuals to be commensurate with the individual's potential involvement.
Okay.
In the security, should all individuals on site be considered to have potential involvement in security emergency and therefore require training? The answer is no, although it's good practice to provide some basic training to all employees, e.g. details on how to respond to an alarm. Only those individuals with security responsibilities must be trained. And so you can give, you know, partial training, training in that's relevant to their responsibilities to people who need it without having to TNR them,
yeah,
unless they have access to the material or to sensitive information.
Well, that's the pattern we followed. We've been doing that now for a few years. The issue there is it seems that they would at least have to know what building on campus we're concerned about, you know, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that, beyond, other than telling them, you know, how to get to it, what there's, and they can't get to it because they don't have the access to it. So they don't have the codes to get in and that sort of thing. So, okay.
Well, again, you know, any detailed questions about this, you know, check with your regulator and your inspector. But as a general matter, telling them how to get to a particular building on campus shouldn't be a concern.
Okay, I'm pretty comfortable with that then. Yeah.
Okay.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you, Andy. Thanks, Paul. Any other feedback on subparts A, B, C, or D?
And again, yes, please press the star 1.
And again, you can submit questions through webinar if you'd like. We'd like to remind you, if you do not submit any feedback today, you should do so by May 13th. You can do it via email or mail the information in. If you go to the public website, you'll see that information on how to submit your comments.
Have Mac again.
I've got a question on interpretation. It's 3723E5. It's about maintaining the list of persons currently approved for unescorted access. And the interpretation question I've got is, it talks about you have to remove that person as soon as possible from the list, but no later than seven working days. Now, my question is this. We typically, because we've got a large number of people authorized, we get an updated list from some of the security person that kind of maintains a lot of this. On a monthly basis, we ask for an updated list. We also tell people that have unescorted access that if they leave the institution, they should notify us that they are doing so, and then we would obviously take them off the list. Now, my question is, let's say a person leaves on the, 5th of May, and we get that list, and they don't notify us that they have left, which we tell them to, but they, of course, people always do what you tell them to do. And then we get the list at the end of the month and find that that person's no longer on that list, or that person is no longer has a badge ID, which is how we determine their access. The question is, are we in violation of that section of the rule?
Do you want to provide feedback on that?
Well, again, I think that's something that your regulator and your inspector would have to have to determine. We've heard this concern before, particularly from universities, where you have students coming and going, and you may have investigators coming and going, and similar things, I think, from large medical institutions. We realize this is potentially an issue,
let me say this. If I were to be called on that, I guess my interpretation is that the clock starts when I determine that person has left. Because the rule says when a licensee determines that a person is no longer. It doesn't say when the person is no longer employed. It says when I determine that.
Right.
Then I've got 7 days to remove him or her from the list. And that would be my interpretation, especially if somebody said, well, you're in violation because that person left 14 days ago and you didn't take them off the list. And I'm going to say, well, I didn't know they had left. The point I'm making is it may be worthwhile to clarify that, or maybe it is clear. As long as that's the way it's interpreted, you know, I don't have a problem with it. But I can see that being interpreted, 7 days when they actually leave. That's just my point.
Yeah, I can't give you a legal interpretation, but I certainly see your point. I think it's worth our trying to clarify that.
Hi. Yeah, this is Bob Gattone, Mac. I can't interpret for the NRC on behalf of the NRC, like Paul said, he can't either. But it appears to me that the rule, the concern about the UAA list being revised. It sounds to me from what I heard from you, Mac, that there's an opportunity to increase or accelerate the communication of those changes so that you have enough time to revise the list within the period of 7 working days.
So you're saying that I need to request that list more frequently?
Well, it's based on what changes, if any, have occurred during over time. So if there is, 100 people on the list and one of them gets removed, you have to update that within 7 working days, as I understand it. So if you're having trouble getting that communication because you only get it every month, I think you said, then you're setting yourself up for potential late revisions.
So there is some place where it says we have to revise that list.
I think you have to keep it updated, and you have to, and if somebody, it has to be revised within 7 days of a change, as I recall.
Okay.
I don't have it in front of me, but.
I'm looking at the rule. It just says when a licensee determines that a person is no longer requires unescorted access or meets the authorization requirement, the licensee shall remove the person from the approved list as soon as possible, but no later than 7 working days.
Right, so as soon as that determination is made, then that's when the clock starts.
Right.
So
Okay. So I agree. I think, and like I said, it may be when I may not be notified within 7 days, but as soon as I am notified, then, you know, we're gonna take them off the list.
Right, but if you're not the one that determines the change, and you don't get notified of the change till after the 7 working days,
right?
Then you're gonna be late. That's why I'm saying the communication needs to be quicker. It sounds like, from what I hear.
Well, I'm making the determination for the licensee.
Okay. Well, okay. Yeah. So then you can do it as soon as you can, or at least in 7 working days. Then.
Right. We're the maintainer of the list. I guess that's the right term.
Okay. Then okay. I guess I didn't totally understand before.
Right. Okay.
Hi, this is Margaret Cervera from the NRC. I was just listening to the discussion, and I'm staring at the requirement, or another requirement that talks about the determination. So maybe this is an opportunity for a place where we can at least update the guidance or something about what exactly that determination is. If that is when you get the list, if you only get it monthly, does the determination happen when the holder of the unescorted access list receives information about employee actions, which could be handled by an HR department or some other place, not the licensee necessarily? Or does that determination happen the day an employee leaves? So maybe am I hearing that could potentially be an opportunity for us to enhance what it is that we're aiming for?
Yeah, I think so, because I mean, as I said, it's a little bit open to interpretation, and I can certainly see it interpreted multiple ways. And so, I think we've pretty much got it covered. Like I said, as soon as we know, and honestly, some people, when they're leaving, they do notify us. I mean, and again, that's part of the training that we provide them. So. 7 days is a pretty short turnaround time, I will say that. But anyway, I think there may be an opportunity, and maybe in your guidance, to clarify.
Thank you. We'll take it under advisement.
Thank you very much. Kathy, do we have anyone else?
There are no more comments or questions at this time.
Great. Thank you. Again, if you have any comments on subparts A, B, C, or D, we'd like to get those comments. We've gotten great comments today. We really appreciate that. Also, if you have some clarifying questions you'd like to ask, we would entertain those also. But we're going to move on to new reg 2155, actually. If you have any comments on new reg 2155, we'd like to hear those comments. Again, I spoke to this earlier. Some stakeholders have actually used New Reg 2155 to help establish their security program. If you have some of that feedback or experience, we'd like to hear from you on that. We've gotten feedback that 2155 is actually too large. It's too much information. Some of the feedback we've given into that respect is that, you know, you could actually do a word search in 2155 if you believe it's too large. But we did get that feedback that it's too much information, that it needs to be less information and more direct information. So it's almost, it's about 2:25, so we do have a couple of hours left that we could provide information. So we would definitely like to get feedback, some of the comments from your perspective. We appreciate the array of stakeholders who've actually registered for the webinar, who's calling in today. We really appreciate it, and those who've actually come here for the public meeting. We really appreciate it. We appreciate all of the comments that we've received thus far during the four webinars and the webinar and public meeting today. So thank you again. And again, I'd like to remind you that if you would like to provide feedback later, just please do so by May 13th for us to consider it for this assessment that we're currently conducting for Part 37. You know, a question was also posed as to how we're going to use the information that we're receiving during the webinars and during the public meeting and webinar today. We're basically taking this information and we're going to bin it, and then we'll have specific comments for each of the subparts, and we'll take that information and consider it for either rulemaking or revising the new regs, or even taking that information and sort of doing further research to get more technical folks involved and get some further stakeholder input to see the impact of those comments. So just want to let you give you some feedback on that. We've actually gotten some feedback saying that New Reg 2155 is a really good product also, that that they appreciate the questions and answers, provide a lot of clarification. If you have that comment, we'd definitely like to hear your experiences there too, that it actually helps a lot to have that product at hand. Hearing no feedback, we're going to move on to New Reg 2166, the best practice guide document. Again, if you'd like to give feedback on subparts A, B, C, D, or New Reg 2155, you can do so at any time during the webinar and public meeting today. Again, we've gotten feedback on New Reg 2166 that it's a good document, and some have actually used that document to help establish their security program. We've also gotten feedback that some believe that we could have gotten the document earlier, and they would have appreciated having it earlier to help establish their program. So if you have some of those comments, we'd like to hear about them. Also, if you're not aware of New Reg 2155 or 2166, we'd like to hear those comments also. We have had interviews, and we've gotten feedback that there have not, where you've had some stakeholders that was actually not aware of New Reg 2155 or 2166. Again, if you provide feedback, we'd like to caution you not to provide any non-public information, safeguarded information, or classified information. And again, we're also entertaining questions. If you have questions for clarity, one of the things we will try to do is if you have questions, we like to try to, you know, bring it back to the format of the seminar, and maybe there is a opportunity for clarity or revision of rule or guidance with you that's sort of embedded in your question. So if you have questions, we will entertain those questions.
Hi, this is Margaret again. I just wanted to bring up, George mentioned that there were people who had mentioned that they weren't aware of the availability of 2155 and 2166. I would like to add to that list the crosswalk that we have available on our public website, which compares the orders that have been in effect for the past, almost 10 years now, and Part 37, so to make it easy to figure out what the differences are between those two sets of requirements and make it just that much easier for licensees to implement. So just a plug for that document as well.
Thank you, Margaret. That is Really good information, really good feedback. We've had some stakeholders not aware of some of the differences between the orders in Part 37, or you know, some may believe that if they're in compliance with the orders, they are in compliance with Part 37, but there are some differences. The orders weren't just codified where there were some other requirements placed in Part 37. So good feedback on the crosswalk. If you're not aware of the document, please go to the website to look at that, the crosswalk document. Again, we'd like to have feedback on or comments on subparts A, B, C, D, new reg 2155 or 2166.
Any comments or questions, press the star one.
Any other comments in the room? Okay, just as a reminder, you can submit your comments via email or you can mail that information to us. Please go to the public website to get that information. We were scheduled to go to 5 o'clock, but if we don't have any other comments, we're gonna close the public meeting and the webinar out at this time. We'll give it about a couple more minutes. If you have any other comments or questions, we would like to entertain that at this time. And again, that could be on subparts A, B, C, D. Or new reg 2155 or 2166. We'd like to say if you have comments, please do not provide any non-public information during your comments. And we've not said it in a while, but all of the comments and the conversations are being recorded. Okay, one last time, Kathy, are there any other comments?
So we do have one coming up. One moment. Go ahead, Karen Sheehan.
Hi, it's Karen again. I just wanted to say that 2155 and 2166 were very helpful with us developing our security plan. In fact, we used the information that is in the appendix security plan contents, appendix A, to keep us focused on writing our security plan, and we actually each took a section and focused on that. So hopefully that comparing it to Part 37, we covered everything that we needed to, and we haven't been inspected yet. We are in agreement state, but hopefully when we are inspected and the inspector looks at our plan, that they are in agreement that we've covered everything we needed to.
Great. Kathy, get one follow-up question. We've gotten feedback from stakeholders that would like to benchmark other licensees. And they, you know, some have questioned as to what type of information or how much information they can share. Have you have any experience in that area?
No. No one's asked me.
Yeah, because I guess the concern is, you know, hey, if I share this information with another licensee, do I have to TNR that person before I share that information? Or so that's just some of the information, one of the comments that we've gotten back. So just wanted to see if you had any kind of experience in that area. Thank you.
You're welcome.
If there's anyone else out there who has experience in it or who've experienced that they would like to either share or benchmark other licensees, but there's a concern there as to does the licensee or individual you're going to share that information with, does it have to be TNR? Do you have to TNR that individual, and how much information you can share?
I have Steve Meyer.
Great.
Hi, this is Steve Meyer, Stars Alliance. I have an unrelated question I wanted to ask before you close out the meeting. I may have missed it earlier, but what is your timeline for evaluation of this feedback, and in what form would we expect to see that? Like, you know, what kind of information or report are you going to produce, and what will happen after that?
Yeah, great. We have a report that's due to Congress in December of this year. So the information we're receiving, we're taking the information back, and we have a team, and some of that team you've heard from today have answered some of your questions and provided some of the feedback to your questions and statements. We all take that information and we sit down and evaluate it to determine, you know, if there are some possible enhancements that we could gather from that information for the new regs, or is there an indicator for rulemaking. There's a separate petition for rulemaking that was submitted that the NRC is considering for Part 37. If there is any recommendation for rulemaking that the commission believes should be included in Part 37, then we'll combine our efforts with that petition for rulemaking. And I think that effort is may start in the fall of this year. But just to emphasize, we have a report that's due to Congress on the effectiveness of the of Part 37 requirements to protect Category 1 and 2 material. So we'll take this information that we have for our to support that report. Congress only asked us to look at the events and the findings. From the violation of the findings from inspections and the material or events for Category 1 and 2 in order to complete that report. We're doing more of a holistic view to support the report, to understand if there are other enhancements that could be gained from taking a hard look at Part 37. We've also had an independent review conducted by some consultants, and their report is going to be part of this review also. And finally, within 2 years after we submit our report to Congress, the GAO will come back out and look at take a look at Part 37, the effectiveness of Part 37.
Okay, thank you for that detailed response.
Great, thank you.
Okay, we have a comment from Mac.
No, sorry, I thought I did, but I don't. My fault.
Yeah, no problem, Mac. And again, if you remember or you think there's something you'd like to comment, you could always submit it via email, or you can mail that information in to us. Okay, we'll give it a couple more minutes, and then we'll close out. It's about 20 till 3. We have a couple of hours left. If you want to make comments, we are here to receive those comments, and we really would like to receive those comments because it helps to have those stakeholders who are actually implementing Part 37 and those who are performing inspection oversight to give the staff the information that to enhance Part 37. We really appreciate the feedback we've gotten thus far from the four webinars and and today the webinar and the public meeting. We really appreciate that feedback. If you have any feedback on any of the subparts, any other subparts or 2155 or 2166, we'd like to get that information at this time.
We do have a comment from Mel.
Okay.
Yes, my name is Mel Frable with Concrete Imaging again. I have a question regarding Green Estate requirements. All our info and documentation at the time of initial reciprocity recognition is handed over to them in order to get the recognition, which they do review and they approve. And then it's updated annually. The requirements for them is that all times when we work on temporary job sites in their state is that we were required to keep a physical documentation with us which has all of our sensitive and non-sensitive information, training materials, everything. This book's 500 and some pages big. As far as security of it, it is secured in the vehicle when it is on a temporary job site.
However, I feel that with the change in times and everything, that I think it needs to be addressed that we need to update this and remove this to a point to where, for one thing, I annually, like with the state of Virginia, I annually update them with my O&E and stuff like that there, like with Perlin, with digital copies of our O&E and stuff of that nature. And what I'm getting to is that it should be to where, instead of having this book, which is actually, I feel, leaving us open for a violation because, I mean, if that truck was to get, I mean, even though the device is not in the truck, it's being utilized on the job site, the truck still, sometimes there's nobody there. And that truck could be, you know, even though it's secured, still could be broken into. They still could get that, blah, blah, blah. I mean, we don't leave it out in the open, but it's not on the dash. But what I'm getting to is I think during this time we should change this to where instead of carrying this physical documentation, we can start carrying like an iPad or something that has a digitally encrypted software on it to where if this thing was, I mean, it would be with the radiographer at all times because, you know, our safety vests and everything we carry now has pockets and such to where we put iPads and stuff in. And he can carry that with him. It's encrypted, password protected and everything. And if it does get lost or stolen or what have you, all I have to do is be notified. Like my own personal cell phone, I have software in that that, you know, I can track it with GPS and notify LEO where it's at, or I can send a kill signal to it to where I can wipe the hard drive and everything, and they'll basically just get an empty tablet or phone or whatever they get. I just wanted to see if that there could be like a change or something that could be brought about, you know, to try to update this, because I do feel vulnerable somewhat with that, you know, with as far as the document control regulations with the federal government and the document regulations I have to deal with the state government. Does that make sense?
Well, for clarity, I don't know if anyone in here has a feedback on that, but yeah, it sounds like you're going to have to take that back to the agreement state to we got it. Okay. Because, you know, and I'm sorry, Mel, I didn't get the entire sequence, okay. but apparently the other team members did, so we'll take it back. Thank you. Oh, do you have a comment?
Yeah, Mel, is there a reference you can give us? Is there a regulation you're talking about?
This is 3731 document control.
3731.
Yeah, I believe that's it.
Okay. But it's only for when you're.
Right. I'm in an agreement state. Like the other day, I just started sending them a notification to where I started using, sensitive, like I do for Virginia, sensitive information, withhold from public disclosure, 2309 and 3732.
Okay.
And I changed their form too because I'm like, I think it's not time for to get in compliance with this more because I'm getting anxious. You know, I'm getting ready to get an audit here pretty soon. I just want to make sure we walk through this one here.
All right, we're gonna have we'll have to figure out how that works on reciprocity.
Yeah. So just to clarify. You kind of threw us here in the room just for a second, I'll be honest. So I think just to clarify so I understand what you're saying. So Part 37 does not require you to carry all of your security plan and your procedures with you at all times. However, what you're telling us is that through reciprocity agreements, another state is requiring that.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, thanks, Mel. Really appreciate that.
All right, thank you.
Okay, it's about a quarter till 3. If you have any other information we'd like to hear it, subparts A, B, C, or D, or New Reg 2155 or 2166, we really appreciate the comment.
That was my first thought, too.
George, I did have one follow-up question to that previous discussion when the individual took the information to an agreement state. The question of that is, the work site that you were at, was that under federal jurisdiction within the agreement state or not?
So, Mel, if you can come off mute and if you can provide an answer to that, we'd appreciate it. Kathy, is Mel coming off mute, or can you, I don't know if you can tell?
There he is. He just came back up.
All right.
Okay, I'm here. It's multiple sites we work at. We work at, you know, I work daily. I work at federal sites, any site. The book is basically, I mean, we're talking human nature here, so yes, the book's in the truck every day.
Yeah, my question then, Mel, is, you know, when you were at the site with that information in an agreement state, was the work location, the temporary job site, let's call it, was that under NRC jurisdiction or federal jurisdiction, or was it an agreement state jurisdiction here?
I'm saying it's an agreement state, although we do, I work in two agreement states now. It was three, but I didn't re-up my reciprocity with Pennsylvania this year because there's really nothing. No work for us up there, no revenue for us, so, I let that one go.
All right, okay. So that clarifies that where you worked in that agreement state was agreement state jurisdiction.
Also, we work federal. I mean, I've worked at NSA and other places, and, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to bring that up, but, we're all over the place. And, okay. This is a document. It's a rather large book we carry, and I think it's time that, I've been doing radiography. I'm getting ready to celebrate my 28th year of doing this, of industrial radiography and structures throughout the metropolitan area. And I think it's time that role should be changed. I mean, everything else is on a cell phone anymore. It's on these smartphones and stuff. Let's go with a mobile app and everything to where I at least can protect this a little bit better, and we can control it a little bit more. That's what I'm after.
Okay, great. Thanks, Mel.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob, for the follow-up question. Okay, one last call for any other comments or feedback from subparts A, B, C, and D, New Reg 2155, 2166.
Again, for any comments, press star 1.
Again, if you're not able to provide feedback today, you can email that information in, or you can mail it to the NRC. If you go to the public website, you'll get that information. Okay, we're going to close the webinar and the meeting, public meeting out. We thank you for your comments. We've looked over all the areas that we're looking for, that we were seeking comments for today from at the public meeting and the webinar. Again, we'd like to say we really appreciate the feedback we've gotten during all the webinars and today also during the webinar and the public meeting. We really appreciate your participation in the meeting today. If you did not log into the webinar, we don't have your contact information, please send that information to part37assessment@nrc.gov. All right, thank you very much. This is the end of the webinar and public meeting.